So we're going to start our service in a moment. So I invite you to stand for the first hymn and the choir will process in a moment. So please stand and let's sing All My Hope on God Is Founded. Of our faithful God. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
If you'd like to be seated. We are here to worship God, whose purposes are good, whose power sustains the world he has made, who loves us even though we have failed in his service. Who gave Jesus Christ for the life of the world, and who by his Holy Spirit leads us in his way of love and of peace. As we give thanks for his great works, we remember this day all those who have lived and died in his service and in the service of others. And we pray for all who suffer as a result of war and conflict. Today we do particularly remember the war in Ukraine, a war which seems so cruel, so unjust and so unending, which has badly impacted the lives and well-being of so many. Many thousands of lives have been lost and millions suffer. So as we pray for peace today and in the days to come, let's keep current warfare in our minds. Also today, we remember our Queen. I'm sure she has come to your minds because she's always been so much a part of Remembrance services as head of our armed forces until so recently. So let's also, with fondness and gratitude, remember her. As we look to the future, we ask for God's guidance and blessings for ourselves, that we may learn lessons from the events of the past, and that we may seek his way of peace in our own lives and for our world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God has been our help throughout our lives, throughout the ages. So we're going to sing together, "Our God, O God, our help in ages past." Please stand. Seated for our act of penitence. Let us confess to God the sins and shortcomings of the world and our own failure to seek and establish that peace which God wills for all of his children. Lord, you made us to be one family, yet we have divided humanity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You came as Prince of Peace to reconcile all people, yet we have brought disharmony amongst races. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You rejoice in our differences, yet we make them a cause of enmity. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who has promised to forgive all who repent of their sins, grant us pardon for our sins, peace in our hearts, strength in his service, and everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Kaylee, representing the parish council, will read our first reading for us. Thank you.
First reading is taken from Micah 4, 1 to 5, the mountain of the Lord. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of all mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, "Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples, and will settle disputes for strong nations far and wide. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, for the Lord Almighty has spoken. All the nations may walk in the name of their gods, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God, forever and ever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Katie. And now Corrie Louds from Box Hill School will read our gospel for us. Thank you, Corrie.
So the second reading is taken from John 15, 9 to 17. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant doesn't know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command: love each other. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Corrie. And now David will give us the address. Thank you, David.
Lord, take my words and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our lives and set them on fire with love for you, now and always.
Amen.
Amen. I suppose as we come to this Remembrance Sunday, looking at the enormous difference in age within this congregation, there will be all sorts of different events that we are recalling as we remember those who have given their lives in war and those who are still fighting to establish peace. And as Sandra reminded us at the beginning, for many, the war in Ukraine will clearly be one of those incidents that will be front of mind for many of us, and rightly so, as we see all the horror of war wrought across a nation simply seeking its own independence. It is extraordinary to think that such a situation can exist at this time in history, and having learned very little, it would seem, from the past. For others, they will be recalling, especially I suspect our younger members from Box Hill, the events in Iran, different in a sense in nature, but nevertheless, people are suffering and indeed are dying in the cause of justice, of peace. People no younger, in fact, younger than many of those from Box Hill School. Again, a horrendous thought. And if you read your magazine, you will see that the people of Palestine, again, are fighting this extraordinary battle to establish themselves. And yet again, the history of the place seems to be completely disregarded as we endeavour to settle yet another area of dispute in our world. And listening to my brother, who works, amongst other things, for human rights in Brazil, the passing of Bolsonaro is an enormous blessing, in as much as none of us, I think, are totally aware of the horrors of that regime that have been wrought on innocent people, tortured, imprisoned, and killed simply because they opposed his extraordinary right-wing views. And you can add and add to those lists. Those of us of my age, and yes, there are some of that age, and yes, even older, who have managed to come here, will of course be recalling the wars that began this act of remembrance, those in the First and Second World Wars, where simply numbers that we can hardly comprehend died in search of peace. It was driven home to me most forcibly a couple of weeks ago when I took three of our grandchildren on a tour of Oxford. And at one point, I saw all three of them standing quietly in front of what looked like an enormous notice board under one of the archways. I went across to see what they were looking at, and they asked me, "What are all these names on these lists?" They were the names of students who had died in the First World War alone. There were 55 names on this particular list, and that is one of 40 colleges in heaven knows how many universities across the country. That is the extent of war and the damage it wreaks on all involved. And our first reaction, of course, is inevitably to deny responsibility for it by blaming other people. We look at the war in Ukraine, and of course we immediately think of that extraordinary tyrant, Putin. We look at the situation in Iran, and we think of the Ayatollah. We look at the situation in Brazil, as I mentioned, or we mention the situation in Palestine and think of whoever may be in power at this particular moment in time. They are to blame. We are innocent victims. But I wonder how true that is. I wonder, even amongst some here today, what thoughts may have been running through your minds as you came into church. Good heavens, there's old so-and-so. He's a grumpy old soul. Good heavens, she's dressed so smartly. I can't believe she goes to so much trouble. Envy beyond belief. You know, she holds the most extraordinary political views. Can't think how she's got the courage to stand here today. Or, you know what's going on in his life. All those thoughts which undermine relationships and multiplied by millions create just the situations that have resulted in those situations that I mentioned earlier, where war and strife reign supreme. So let's go back to the basics. Let's recall, if you can, the words from our second reading from St. John's Gospel and see what we can learn from them. Jesus says, "Love one another as I have loved you." Now, for some of you, this word love will inevitably divert your thoughts. The word love, as it is found in the New Testament, is a Greek word. We needn't worry about that. There are about four or five different words that are used to translate the one word that we use, love. And this word that appears in this reading is agape. And that is the meaning that reappears time and time and time again. Sandra will be able to tell you how many times in the New Testament. It's a sort of figure that we learn when we're at theological college. Can you remember? Because I can't. But the important thing is to realize that the word agape is to do with a kind of selfless love, a love that doesn't seek anything in return, that has the other person front of mind. It isn't that sort of sloppy Valentine type love. It doesn't actually require, doesn't expect anything in return. Indeed, you can love other people in the sense of agape without them necessarily liking you or you them. So don't confuse this word love, but bear in mind it is the word love, not like. We use the word like very lightly, you know, oh, he's okay, you know, quite like him, whatever. I had a wonderful statement only the day before yesterday when someone was talking about a neighbour and said, I simply don't like her, full stop. And we wonder why we haven't got peace. Jesus goes on to expand in this reading, which comes just before he is preparing for his own death and crucifixion. He goes on to say, greater love has no person than this, that they are prepared to lay down their life. And that is at the very heart of this search for what we need in our world today. It is an extraordinary thought, but love in the sense in which I have described it, that selfless love that can see the best in other people, that has a spirit of generosity and empathy about it, will drive people to do things for other people that they wouldn't conceivably have done if they had simply kind of liked them. It is a much more engaging and involving term, and one that all of us need to hold on to firmly. And as an example, there is the life of Jesus, a man whose life was lived in this extraordinary spirit of agape, of love for other people. We know there are people he didn't like, there are people he didn't agree with, but he nevertheless died for them all. And that is something we all need to hold on to. And it is more than just creating a just world. A just world in which justice reigns is good and very important. Justice removes a number of the barriers that divide us one from another. But of its own, it does not create the kind of loving society that we want. You can have a just world, but it may not be a loving or forgiving one necessarily. That is what we need to put in place, and we are given as our inspiration and as our constant support the assurance that God is with us. There is that extraordinary phrase towards the end of that reading, you did not choose me, no, I chose you. All of us here have been loved by God and have been chosen by him. If we decide not to pick up the chance, that is up to us, but it is there on offer. And it can and will transform the world in which we live, if we live with a view to trying to create a more loving, a world in which selfishness comes to secondary position and selflessness rises to the top. When we are able to think how we would like other people to treat us, rather than necessarily expecting them simply to take us as we are. That is the world that we are challenged by today to set out once more to recreate. And if ever there was a need to do so, Ukraine stands front of mind as to what happens if we fail to take up this challenge. And God is beside us. We heard from the words of Micah, I will settle the disputes among nations far and wide. I will turn their swords into plowshares, and I will turn their spears into pruning hooks. If they allow peace and love to flow in their hearts and allow the Lord to guide them, now and always. Amen.
Thank you, David. Now is an opportunity to listen to the choir, who will remind us that God is with us, but also perhaps to decide in our own hearts that we are going to be more loving and we're going to be peacemakers. So let's remain seated and enjoy hearing the choir. Thank you. A bit more about the horrors of war. Thank you, Claire.
In Flanders Fields by John McCrae. In Flanders Fields the poppies blow between the crosses, row on row, that mark our place, and in the sky the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe, to you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
It's always very moving to hear that poem. We're now going to ask God to help us to be channels of peace, and we will be taking the collection as we sing, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. Please stand.
Faith in
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the work of the Royal British Legion, for all that they do, for service men and women who've been injured, and for the families of those who have been lost. We pray that you will take what we've been able to give on these plates and use them to show love and to promote peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So now we come to our time of intercession. So if you'd like to be seated, Tim, our church warden, will lead us. Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith, as we give thanks today for those who made the ultimate sacrifice so that we can live in peace, we pray that you will bless all who now serve in our armed forces, both here and overseas. Equip them with the resources they need to fulfill their mission, providing security to this nation, fighting evil, confronting oppression and terror, and working for just and lasting peace. Protect them from danger, give them help in adversity, courage in moments of fear, and coolness in times of crisis, enfolding them and their loved ones in your gracious care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thinking particularly of the ongoing war in Ukraine, and praying that the ceasefire in the Ethiopian conflict will last, hear us now as we pray for the victims of war everywhere, for those soldiers and civilians who bear the scars of conflict, the injured, the maimed, and mentally distressed, those left homeless or as refugees, those who have lost their livelihoods and security, and those who still live in daily fear for their and their loved ones' lives. We pray especially for children who have been injured or orphaned, parents who mourn their children, all who have lost loved ones and whose lives will never be the same again. Grant them the knowledge that you are with them, sharing their pain and moved by their sorrow, your love reaching out to them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, in our own community, there are also those who suffer. And we pray now for Ken and his wife, Wendy, and their family, for Richard's daughter, Carrie, and for Serena and her family on the recent sad death of Serena's son, Andreas. Commending Andreas and all of those we know who are in need or grief, or who have passed on from this life into your loving arms. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of all, we pray that you will grant wisdom to world leaders and politicians as they make decisions on matters of war and peace, climate change, and other major issues that affect us all. That we ask that you will help us to respond to your Son's loving example, to be peacemakers in our own communities and in the world, and to be responsible stewards of this beautiful but vulnerable environment that you have given us. And we pray especially for young people who have so much to offer, so many fresh ideas, so much vigour and enthusiasm, yet who are faced by all kinds of pressures and demands. Guide them, we pray, in their work and studies. Encourage them in responding to the challenges they face, and show them your way for the future. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let's remain in an attitude of prayer and say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Now is an opportunity for us to make our own act of commitment as we seek to move out from here more determined to work for peace and to love as Christ loves us. So please stand. Father of all people and lover of all you have made, as on this day we hold in grateful remembrance those who have died in time of war, we pray that the leaders of the nations may seek your righteousness, so the whole world may find the peace only you can bring. Lord of all nations, we remember before you with grateful hearts the men and women who in the day of decision ventured all for the liberties we now enjoy. Help us to recognise the incalculable debt we owe them, that we may strive in our own time to maintain the true freedom in our nation and to safeguard that peace which was won at so great a cost to so many. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us now pledge ourselves anew to the service of God and our fellow men and women, that we may help, encourage, and comfort others, and support those working for the relief of the needy and for the peace and welfare of all the nations. Will you then strive for all that makes for peace?
We will.
Will you seek to heal the wounds of war?
We will.
Will you work for a just future for all humanity?
We will.
Together. Lord God, our Father, we pledge ourselves to serve you and all people in the cause of peace, for the relief of want and suffering, and for the praise of your name. Guide us by your Spirit. Give us wisdom, give us courage, give us hope, and keep us faithful now and always. Amen. Please remain standing and we will sing I Vow to Thee, My Country.
Thank you.
remain standing for the blessing, which will be followed by the national anthem. God grant us peace. Peace to our world, peace in this land, peace in our community, peace amongst family and friends, and peace in our own hearts and minds. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon each of you and those you love, this day and always. Amen.
Amen.
For a few moments of quiet. Thank you.
If you need to sit down, there is a seat here. You're feeling lovely to gather before the War Memorial. David will lead us in the first part where we remember the names. We'll have the last post and 2 minutes silence and then the reveille. So if you'd like to just pause for a moment. This is a particular village moment in one way as we remember the dead on our War Memorial. David.
Let us remember before God and commend to his sure keeping those who have died for their country in war, those whom we knew and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of mankind. In our own community, we remember Private Frederick George Berryman, Bombardier Percy Bodman, Private Sidney Davis Burford, Private Edward Henry Clark, Private William Collins, Private Henry Edgington, Private William Alfred Edgington, Corporal Frederick Richard Field, Lieutenant Colonel Bernard Sorwell Gristle and Lieutenant Francis Gristle and Private Oliver Snelling. And amongst those who died in the Second World War, we remember Sergeant Dennis Barber, Steward Ralph David Blackman, Corporal Kenneth Butcher, Lieutenant Alan William Keith Foxon, Captain Roger Fiddyplace Lawrence, Sergeant Derek Douglas Northfield, Lieutenant Peter Kenneth Lynch Odoms, Captain Donald Guy Pierce, Flight Lieutenant Harold George Henry Phipps, Sergeant Edgar William Sawyer, and Driver Brinley Marcus Williams.
All this stuff, all this speech about published men.
And there may be those known to us as the worst Barry who we wish to remember. So in a moment of silence, if any of your own family or your own concepts or context, then just remember those for a moment before we continue.
We pray especially today for those who have died fighting for the independence and freedom of citizens of Ukraine. May even as we speak, be surrendering their lives, protect the lives of others. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember.
We will remember them.
When you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we gave our today. Almighty and eternal God, from whose loving Christ we cannot be parted, either by death or life, hear our prayers and thanksgivings for those whom we remember this day, fulfill in them the purpose of your love, and bring all your people to your eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you very much for being here. Do go and enjoy the refreshments that Foxhill School have kindly laid on for us. And thank you very much to our Beaver who did such a lovely job for us. Thank you very much. Thank you.